Can I have a pulpit, please? Thank you. There goes all the stuff. While we wait for a pulpit, you can open your Bibles to 2 Corinthians 8. If you are a visitor this morning, this is a family moment. If you are not in another church and you're just visiting Solid Ground, you've come on a very unique Sunday. And this morning we speak to the church. This morning we speak to believers predominantly. We prayed this morning that even as we go into a very practical aspect of our faith, i.e. our generosity, that every heart will be moved, and even those that are unsaved this morning will hear the gospel message through the preaching of the word. So Father God, we come before you, we present our hearts, Lord. I pray that you will do open heart surgery this morning. And like I said, even though this is a very practical and a very topical message this morning, Father God, I pray that we will be cut to the heart by the message of the gospel and your generosity, Jesus, that you died on the cross for our sins. That's the biggest gift we can ever get. In Jesus' name, amen. So we got a lot of ground to cover in the scripture. I'm sure you can follow on screen with me. I'm reading from the CSB, Christian Standard Bible. 2 Corinthians 9, we'll read 8. 2 Corinthians 8, we'll read from verse 1 to 9. And then we'll jump to chapter 9, and we'll read from verse 1 to 15. So buckle up. We want you to know, brothers and sisters, about the grace. Say grace. We want you to know, brothers and sisters, about the grace of God that was given to the churches of Macedonia. During a severe trial brought about by affliction, their abundant joy and their extreme poverty overflowed in a wealth of generosity. Now, if that doesn't baffle your brain. During a severe trial brought about by affliction, their abundant joy and their extreme poverty overflowed in a wealth of generosity on their part. It blows my mind. We'll get into that just now. I can testify that according to their ability and even beyond their ability, of their own accord, they begged us earnestly for the privilege of sharing in the ministry to the saints, and not just as we had hoped. Instead, they gave themselves first to the Lord and then to us by God's will. So we urged Titus that just as he had begun, so you should also complete among you this act of grace. Now, as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, knowledge, and in diligence, and in your love for us, excel also in this act of grace. I'm not saying this as a command, rather by means of diligence of others. I'm testing the genuineness of your love, for you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Though he was rich, for your sake he became poor, so that by his poverty you might become rich. We're jumping to 2 Corinthians 9, verse 1 to 15. He says, still Paul writing to the Corinthians. He says, now concerning the ministry to the saints, it is unnecessary for me to write to you, for I know your eagerness, and I boast about you to the Macedonians. Achaia has been ready since last year, and your zeal has stirred up most of them. But I am sending the brothers so that our boasting about you in this matter would not prove empty, and so that you would be ready, just as I said. Otherwise, if the Macedonians come with me and find you unprepared, we, not to mention you, would be put to shame in this situation. Therefore, I consider it necessary to urge the brothers to go on ahead to you and arrange in advance the gift, the generous gift you promised, so that it would be ready as a gift and not as extortion. When the church starts speaking about money, friends, it's not extortion. It's kingdom. We need to understand that. I just want to throw that thought in there. Verse 6. The point is this. Say the point is this. I mean, this is a conclusion. The point is this. The person who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and the person who sows generously will also reap generously. Each person should do as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or out of compulsion, since God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make every grace overflow to you, so that in every way, always having everything you need, you may excel in every good work. As it is written, he distributed freely, he gave to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. Now to the one who provides seed to the sower and bread for food, also provide and multiply your seed and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way for all generosity, which produces thanksgiving to God through us. For the ministry of this service is not only supplying the needs for the saints, but also overflowing in many expressions of thanks to God. Because of the proof provided by this ministry, they will glorify God for your obedient confession of the gospel of Christ and for your generosity in sharing with them and with everyone. And as they pray on your behalf, they will have deep affection for you because of the surpassing grace of God in you. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. And as I read through that, my mind goes through that video that we just saw. And I see how what was happening in that passage has been translated into a video of what Solid Ground has done. What a beautiful thing. So buckle up. This morning is about finance. If you have a weird view of finance and if you're offended of the church speaking about finance, I actually do not apologize. I've got an interesting view on it, and you will hear it throughout. If you are a visitor this morning, I pray that you will be blessed, even in a very practical word, to a local church. Interesting statement, a guy named John Wesley. I don't know if you know who John Wesley was. He was the father and the founder of the Methodist Church. He made a statement, and I deliberated long and hard whether I'm going to share this statement, but I'm going to go for it, so if it offends you, I'm sorry. He said that that the last part of a man to be converted is his wallet. Sounds like something Jesus said in another language, eh? Where your treasure is, there your heart will be. Generosity, friends, it's not a natural thing. Our sinful natures screams mine. Heads up to or thumbs up to the parents who's listened to Nemo for the 300th time. But the human heart, I think one of the first words that a little toddler learns is mine, of los, of meine, here. We've got a joke, I've said it before, I hope I'm not embarrassing, but one of my sister's first words was meine, los eight. los eight. You see, we are born into a sinful nature with a sinful drive, a default setting of self-preservation, self-fulfillment, and self-gratification. That's our nature, friends. Even when non-believers or people from other faith groups appear to be generous, I believe that it's with ulterior motive. There's some ulterior motive of getting something out of it. They believe that they need to do that to get into eternity, or they need to somehow barter and trade to get their salvation or their freedom or to get good things from whoever they pray to. But friends, true generosity, the type that does not expect anything in return and is not driven by self-ambition or selfishness, that true generosity only comes as a grace gift from God. It is only when we truly understand the gospel, how much God gave to us, when we can freely give without expectation, that we can be freely generous without expecting anything in return. And yet God gives us so much in return when we are generous. Paul writes, he says, "We want you to know, brothers and sisters, about the grace of God that was given to the churches of Macedonia." Romans 12, verse 6 to 8 says, "According to the grace given to us, we have different gifts. If prophecy, use it according to the proportion of one's faith. If service, use it in service. If teaching, in teaching. If exhorting, in exhortation. If giving, with generosity." You see, it's a gift, friends. "Leading with diligence, showing mercy with cheerfulness." But giving with generosity is a gift from God, is a grace gift. Now you can ask yourself, how does, and I mean we went into that now, we highlighted it, how does a severe trial by great affliction and extreme poverty translate into generosity? I mean, how many of us, I don't know how many of you budget, but I budget every month diligently. I believe it's a good way of steering my finances. But how many of us have ever stared down a budget sheet that's not balancing and thinking, I need to be more generous? have I never said. No one does that. We don't look at our finances that's not working out and thinking, hey, maybe I should be more generous. But that's what the Macedonians did. For some reason, friends, something happened in their hearts. And in severe trial, severe poverty, affliction, it translated in joy and generosity. It doesn't make sense. Now, many people believe that in the church we shouldn't speak about money. Some get quite offended about it. I've heard it once said. I haven't gone and checked it myself, and I don't think I'll ever have the sort of desire to really go into it. But somebody once said to me that Jesus speaks more about money, our resources, our treasure, than what he speaks about love. Now, how true that is, please don't quote me on that. I don't know. But the point is, Jesus has a lot to say about where we apply and how we apply and how we work with our resource that is given to us. There's so much. I'm gonna just mention six quick verses here. And I'm paraphrasing, so you can go look them up for yourselves if you want to get the full context of the verses. But Matthew 6:24, Jesus reminds us that we cannot serve two masters. You cannot serve both God and money. You need to choose. You'll either elevate the one and suppress the other, or vice versa. Luke 12:32, do not store up for yourself earthly treasure. Where your treasure is, there your heart will also be. Mark 10:24, it's easier for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom. Now, what this is saying, friends, is that it means that wealth can be a deterrent to kingdom life and a kingdom mindset, okay? That if we've got no need for God in our mindsets and wealth can sort of supplement that whatever we could need, then it's difficult to come to God. So our wealth can be a deterrent. That's a warning in that Mark 10:24 scripture. Luke 12:13, be on your guard against all kinds of greed. Luke 16:10, if we cannot be trusted with earthly riches, how will we be entrusted with kingdom riches? Mark 12:41, and this is probably one of my favorite verses, is where the widow goes and she throws two copper coins into the offering basket. And Jesus takes this as a moment to teach his disciples that he's actually after our hearts, not after our wallets. And that this woman has given everything she has by giving two copper coins. And he is actually after our hearts. Now, if we look at the evidence there and we see how much Jesus, and I mean, this is scratching the surface. There's New Testament, there's Old Testament, there's so many passages in the Bible that refer to how we steward our resources. And if we believe that 2 Timothy 3:16, all scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching, for rebuking, for correcting, for training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be completely equipped for every good work. Friends, then I believe that the church should speak on the things that Jesus spoke about. I believe the church should be verbal about it. Now, I'm not saying that we should spend all our time. I'll touch on that later. I think some churches take that into the extreme and they really make church a business, which it is not. It's a kingdom vehicle. But I'm a firm believer that it's because churches have been too embarrassed, and for some reason there's something come into theology that makes churches scared to speak about finances and about money. And for that reason, the typical church goer has got a warped understanding around their finances and their resource. Once again, I think if we pay too much attention to it, I think there's also a risk there, but it's definitely not a taboo, and it's definitely not a thou shalt not enter these gates lest thee be struck by lightning from above. Because that is how some pastors, preparing for the sermon, somebody said to me, yeah, that's a tough one to speak about money. I'm like, no, it's not. It's God's word. It's really God's word. And that's not a rebuke to the person that said that. It's just, that's where I am, God's word. I believe that God wants us to have a healthy theology around our resources. I believe that he's blessed and entrusted us. Every one of us has got a measure of faith, a measure of resource that is entrusted. And whether it's the two copper coins of the widow or whether it's the 2 million rand of the philanthropist, God wants us to steward that well. He's after our hearts, not our wallets. That was the longest intro in the history of intros. Are you still with me? Amen. Okay, so back to our passage. So the year is around 55 AD. Apostle Paul has been going around for some time now. This is actually the second time that he's asking for donations for the Jerusalem church. The church is persecuted under great affliction, and he wants to take a financial gift to that church to bring relief. And it's also a bit of it's a funny one. It doesn't really fit into my sermon right now, but it's interesting how the Jerusalem church was influential in establishing the Gentile church, but there's still a little bit of animosity between the Jews and the Gentiles. And how beautiful is it that Paul now goes to the Gentiles and says, you need to be a blessing to the Jerusalem church in this way. Another sermon, but beautiful. Beautiful how God orchestrates this in order to bring unity in the church. Second thing I think we need to realize is that I believe that Paul is gathering a special offering. So this morning, we are speaking about faith offering. We're not speaking about tithes and offerings. For me, tithes and offering and the way we've adapted, and there's many biblical arguments for and against the principle of tithing. In Solid Ground, we believe in a monthly tithe. We believe that we honor God with the first fruits of our income. We bring our tithe to the church for the general running, day-to-day running of the church. And then over above that, we give a faith offering. And once again, this is a free will offering. This is a free will giving. There's no compulsion. There's nothing that forces us in the Bible. I'm going ahead of myself, but to give in any way. This practice was adopted by the early Christian church, and there's definitely a separation between the tithe and the free will offering. In Solid Ground, we've sort of adopted this principle of tithing and offerings, and then our faith offering, which is our mission at home, mission away, and justice and compassion, as you've seen on the video. So when we speak of generosity, it's about faith giving. It's about over and above our regular tithe. Tithing is another sermon, or if you've got questions about it, you're welcome to come speak to one of the elders after the service. But three questions I want to address this morning. These are three very, very simple, very practical. It actually felt too simple to preach on. But I really feel it's a pastoral moment where we can learn from God's word. So firstly, the question is, why should I give? Which is a good question. Why should I give? What is the appropriate attitude of my giving? I believe that according to Scripture, that if our attitude towards our giving is wrong, it will not be honored by God. And then how do I decide how much to give and how much to keep? Is that a question anybody has asked? I've asked myself. How much should I give and how much should I keep? What is reasonable? What is fair in one sense? I don't know if fair is the right word to use, but what is godly? What is the godly way? What do I give and what do I keep? So these questions. Why should I give? What is my attitude of giving? And how do I decide what to give and what to keep? So why should I give? Okay, now this is a bit of a tongue twister. So on the why should I give question, I first want to tell you why you shouldn't. The reason that you shouldn't give. Okay, no, that doesn't make sense. You should give, but there's certain reasons that people have applied to their giving that is not biblical. Okay, so those are the things. What should not be my motivation for giving? There's the right word to it. I wrote here, why should I not give? You should. Okay, so what are some of the reasons that people have derived somehow warping God's word and taking Scripture out of context and then applying it to their faith? And I don't believe this is a godly way of giving. If in any way you feel legally obligated to give, if it's a legal thing for you, if you feel that if you don't give, you are not saved, or in some way God has an angry taskmaster that says, thou shalt. Friends, giving is, for the New Testament believer, it is not a must. It's I want to. You are saved by grace, not by what you do or do not give. It says here in 2 Corinthians 9 verse 7, each person should do as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or out of compulsion. One of the other reasons why we shouldn't give, yes, this language is going to get difficult, is because you want God to bless you more. This is the health, wealth, and prosperity gospel. Okay? I believe it is true. The Bible does say, Jesus did say that he is more blessed to give than to receive. Jesus did say that he loves a cheerful giver. But God looks at the motive of the heart, friends. Trying to twist his arm for more earthly blessings by giving more or by thinking that if I give, I will receive. Friends, that's bad theology. My brother-in-law once attended a church and he's got a kidney disease. And at that time, he didn't grow up in the church. And the principle of tithing wasn't really, he was still chewing on it and working with it. And after some time of praying for healing and the healing didn't happen, the pastor came to him and said to him that it's because you don't tithe that God isn't healing you. It's your punishment. Friends, that's rubbish. That's the biggest load of hogwash. That is not God's word. Whether God chooses to give or withhold is totally dependent on his sovereign will. God knows best. Say to the friend to your left, God knows best. Say the friend to the right, God is good. Friend, God is good and God knows best. And whether that best is to give or to withhold, when we are in God's will, we are in his will, full stop. What we give or don't give has got absolutely no effect on whether or not God will heal or not heal. Giving your tithe or free will offering is an act of obedience and a response to God's new covenant law. You know what the new covenant law is? God says he writes his law on our hearts. And all of a sudden, it's not because we must, friends. This law says I obey, not because I must, because I want to. Because I've received God's grace, and as an overflow of gratefulness, I respond in obedience and in generosity. God writes his laws in our hearts, friends. It's not the Old Testament law anymore. Jesus came, he fulfilled that law, but now he writes those laws in our hearts. And now it's from overflow. Nowhere in the Bible does God promise health, wealth, and prosperity as a reward for our giving. Christ is our reward. Yes, in heaven there will be rewards. I believe in heavenly rewards. I believe in doing good. I believe in giving. I believe in all these things. But friends, if you think it's going to earn you any naughty badges with God, you're going to be disappointed. The fullness of Christ, what Nathan said this morning, is ours in him. We don't give for recognition before others. Matthew 6 warns us. Jesus warns us in the Sermon on the Mount. He says, be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of others to be seen by them. Otherwise, you have no reward with your Father in heaven. So whenever you give to the poor, don't sound a trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and on the streets, to be applauded by people. Truly, I tell you, they have the reward. So they've received the reward. So if your left hand knows what your right hand is doing, so if you proclaim whatever you give, you've received your reward on earth, yeah, and you've got no reward in heaven. But when you give to the poor, don't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Brilliant scripture, I think. So what is the motivation for our giving? Why do we give? Well, from the passage that we read in 2 Corinthians 8, verse 2 says, their abundant joy and their extreme poverty overflowed in a wealth of generosity. So I believe that the joy of the Lord should be our first and foremost sort of motivation, or one of the motivations why we give. Why? Because of verse 5, 8 verse 5, it says, instead they gave themselves first to the Lord and then to us by God's will. So the way we view and manage our physical resource should be the barometer of our relationship with God. So if I come to a place, and I've used this analogy before, but for those of you that haven't heard it, when I start worrying about tomorrow, when I start worrying about my pension or what's going to happen, or my resource, or if I start holding on to my finances a little bit more, friends, the first thing I ask myself is, Rinus, how is your relationship with God going? How's your quiet time? Because there's a direct relation in between my relationship with God and the way I see my tomorrow and my provision for my tomorrow. So I use my finances as a barometer. So the joy of the Lord is one of the reasons why we give. I believe that generosity is modeled by the early church in Acts 2 verse 44 to 47 and Acts 4 verse 34 to 37. In both these cases, we see the early church. They come to salvation, they join the community, and all of a sudden they start selling possessions. They start giving away, they start making sure there's no need amongst them. So the generosity flows from day one of the establishment of the New Testament church. Generosity has been a hallmark of the church. We see that Joseph, a Levite from Cyprus, I think that's Acts 4 verse 36. Joseph, a Levite from Cyprus by birth, the one the apostle called Barnabas, which was translated son of encouragement, sold a field he owned, brought the money, and laid it at the apostles' feet. So you see, it is historical known fact that the church has been the church from early Christendom were known for their lavish generosity and hospitality. Even the word hospitality comes from the Christian faith. Word hospital, hospitality, all this language comes from the Christian faith, because that is what happens in the person's heart when Jesus gets hold of him. In the same way, we see that Macedonians, that was the response of the Macedonian church that Paul is writing about. They respond with great generosity towards the kingdom of God. I believe we give because it's always been the way of the people of God. We look at the Old Testament Mosaic law, look after the orphan and the widow, provide for foreigners. The way the Israelites were to design their fields and to harvest their fields was set up in a way that we would look after the orphan and the widow and to be generous. Some feasts and practices, the year of bounty, jubilee, all these things were aimed at generosity and justice and compassion. And then we see God's promise to Abraham. His descendants will be blessed and they will be a blessing to the nations. So friends, generosity has always been a hallmark of God's people from the Old Testament right through into the New Testament. And then lastly, and I think this is the greatest motivator, is from overflow of our gratitude. That is why we give. Because we understand that God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, so that whoever believes will not perish but have eternal life. How can I not respond to that with gratitude? How can I not respond with that with an open heart and an open hand? Okay, so is there a correct attitude to my generosity? I believe giving should be joyful and sacrificial, both and. I think a good measure, and this is my point three only, that I'm going to, but a good measure of how to give is you need to ask yourself, is this sacrificial? You see, friends, for some of us, I believe it's become too easy to give the 200 rand note and nothing of my time. And there's some of us that need to hear this morning, rather put your 200 rand note back in your pocket and come and serve at the next Love Middleburg or go on the next mission trip. Because it's become too easy just to give, because we've got a lot of, okay? So God wants our time, our talent, and our treasure. All of that. He wants all of our lives. Okay, so giving should be joyful and sacrificial, both and. It says, during severe trial brought about by affliction, their abundant joy and extreme poverty overflowed in a wealth of generosity on their part. The church for too long has just had a mission fund. I remember being part of a church many years ago, and there was this mission fund, and then once a year they would come back and tell you how much they gave to the Bible Society and how much they gave to the missionary in Vietnam, but nobody was going nowhere. Friends, if we don't go, the gospel won't be spread. It's not just about sending money to the missionary in Vietnam. Is that good? Time, talent, treasure. Giving that is not sacrificial lacks the power to transform the giver. It may bring relief on some mission front or something. But friends, if you want to see transformation in your life, your giving needs to be sacrificial. God is after our hearts, not our wallets. I'll repeat that over and over and over again. Next reason, or next attitude of giving open hearts and open hands. It says in 2 Corinthians 9 verse 1 to 2, now considering the ministry to the saints, it is unnecessary for me to write to you, For I know your eagerness, and I boast about you to the Macedonians. Achaia has been ready since last year, and your zeal has stirred up most of them. Paul says, it's unnecessary for me to write these things to you, because the natural response of the New Testament Christian should be generosity. So it's actually unnecessary for me to write to you. It's unnecessary for me actually to get up on stage this morning and preach to you on this matter, because it should be a natural response. I've got a quote here from Michael Eaton. I love Michael Eaton, a really solid theologian, passed away a couple of years ago. But this guy spent his years up in Africa preaching to people, to various people groups. He really gave his life to just studying God's word. He's a beautiful theologian. He says, there's a quote up there. I doubt whether great showmanship is necessary to raise funds for anything that is really in the will of God. I doubt whether financial appeal should take more than a few minutes. God's people respond to need where they see it. I reckon that intense 20-minute long money-raising appeals are a discredit to the gospel, says the guy that's been up here for 25 minutes preaching to you. But friends, I think it's a good thing to have a good theology. And this is not just appeal for you to give towards faith offering. But I want us to have a good theology around our giving. I believe an attitude of giving is a privilege. They begged us earnestly for the privilege of sharing in the ministry of the saints, 8 verse 4. When I read this, I was reminded of Acts 5, where the disciples got persecuted. And they went back rejoicing at the fact that they were counted worthy of suffering for the sake of the name, for the sake of Jesus' name. And in the same way, friends, when we give towards a project of God, giving is a privilege. What a privilege to be counted worthy to be part of God's story. What a privilege that I can take whatever resource God has enabled me anyway, the fact that I can work, the fact that I can earn, the fact that I have resource. Every good gift is from God, friends. So God has given me anyway. What a privilege that I can sow that back into God's kingdom and see the fruit of it expand. And then lastly, faith that God will provide all my needs is an attitude necessary for biblical giving. It says here, 2 Corinthians 9 verse 10, now the one who provides seed for the sower and bread for food will also provide and multiply your seed and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way for all generosity. So interesting, you will be enriched in every way for all generosity. Friends, I believe the more we give, the more God enables us to give, which produces thanksgiving to God through us. For the ministry of the service is not only supplying the needs of the saints, but also overflowing in many expressions of thanks to God. So many churches are thanking God because of the generosity of this house. So many churches have been the beneficiary. So many people have been the beneficiary of this house. Many have been saved. Many have been led to Christ. Many have been given spaces to worship. Places, I remember trips up to Malawi where we went and built churches where people were gathering in these little tarpaulin churches. And we went to go and build churches for them so the church can gather and worship in a safe space. What a blessing. And many people worship God because of that. But we need faith, friends. We need faith to trust God that He will provide for our tomorrow. And that's the attitude of our giving. Band, you guys can come up. I'm landing my plane. So, biggest question this morning, how do I decide? How do I give? How much I give? How much I keep? Thanks for asking that. It's a lovely question to answer. I want to remind us of Mark 12, verse 41, where Jesus sits with his disciple and the widow comes and gives him her coins. Two copper coins, which was worth absolutely nothing, really. He summoned his disciples and he said to them, truly I tell you, this poor widow has set more into the treasury than all others. For they all gave out of their surplus, but she, out of her poverty, has put in everything she had, all she had to live on. Last year, I'm going to add this story. I didn't have it in my notes. Last year with our Faith Offering Sunday, we launched the Building Fund. And the week after, there was a Thrive meeting. And an old lady in a wheelchair, she was quite frail. I went over to meet with the people at the Thrive meeting, and she reached into a purse, and she had a envelope in her hand, and it was a tithes and offering envelope, and scratched out, wrote on solid ground, Building Fund. And this is a couple that is they don't have much. And she reached into a handbag, and she gave this to me. And she said to me, "Son, I've got faith for the future of this church." I never opened that envelope. I gave it to my wife. I didn't want to know how much was in there. But that widow, well, she wasn't a widow, but that couple gave everything they had, sacrificially. I had to walk away from her because I couldn't gather myself to speak with her further. It was such an emotional moment for me. I cry easy, if you knew. Welcome to church. I'm the crying pastor. But what a moment that was for me, that a lady that's probably not got many years left has got faith for the future of this house. And then I ask myself, how much do I give and how much do I keep? I don't know, friends. Let's ask God to lead us. Once again, friends, God is after your heart, not your wallet. The physical amount of what you give and what you don't give is actually of no effect to God. All the wealth in the world belongs to Him. He says if we won't call out to Him, He will get the rocks to call out to Him. What a tragedy that would be. Friends, if we choose not to give, the church chooses not to give, God will find a way. He will build His church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against her, with or without our participation. It will happen. We get to participate with God in His mission. 2 Corinthians 9 verse 6 to 7, I think, answers our question. The point is this: the person who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and the person who sows generously will also reap generously. Each person, say each person. Each person should do as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly out of compulsion, since God loves a cheerful giver. 2 Corinthians 8 verse 3 to 4, I can testify that according to their ability, and even beyond their ability. So with the Macedonians, some of them gave to their ability, and some of them had a great gift of faith that God has given them to give over and above their ability. Of their own accord, they begged us earnestly for the privilege of sharing the ministry of the saints. Friends, God is not offended by our wealth. So how much do I keep? God is not offended by our wealth, and He's also not worried about what we don't have. He will look after our tomorrow. In His infinite wisdom, for some reason, He allows some to have much and some don't have much. But friends, God is after our hearts. He's looking at the heart. And no matter how much you give, how much you keep, God is after our hearts. When deciding what to give, ask God to give you great faith and the grace gift of generosity. I think it's a beautiful thing to have. And then ask Him to show you and give you the ability to know how much you should give. That's the best answer I can get to you from Scripture. Not reluctantly, not out of compulsion. If you feel there's a gun to your head this morning, friends, it's not what I'm doing. I pray that will not be the case. But trusting that God is able to make every grace overflow to you so that in every way, always having everything you need, you may excel in every good work. Amen. Amen. Father God, I pray, Lord, really whatever I said that may be offensive, whatever I said that is anything else than what you want people to hear, Father God, I pray that you'll protect our hearts in this moment, Lord. I pray that nobody will feel compelled, but as an overflow of what you have done to us, Father God, we'll give joyfully. You love a cheerful giver. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So you may have seen on your seats, every second seat is a faith offering commitment card. I want to ask the elders to come and join me up on stage. Elders and wives, quickly, if you guys can come up on stage. There's been a lot of honoring this morning, but I want to honor this team. Let's give them a minute to come up. Where's my vrou? Mam Fundies. I want to honor this team for diligently stewarding this church, not just the finances of this church, but the direction, the discipline, and the doctrine of this church fall squarely on the shoulders of these guys. Yes, Jesus is the ultimate shepherd, but he's instilled shepherds into the local house to steward the house. The finances of this house has always been stewarded so well. And I want to thank and I want to honor this team. We sometimes don't agree on everything that we should give towards, but in some way God brings us in unity. And we prayerfully consider what to give to and what not to give to, where to give and where to withhold, when to have an open hand and when to not. But I believe there's so much spiritual wisdom and just so much devotion to Christ on this stage. Friends, and I want to honor this team. Let's give them a hand. So every year we do the faith offering moment. So what is this about? It's basically a commitment that we make towards the faith offering initiative, which is mission at home, mission away, and justice and compassion. Those three components, what we saw in the video this morning. And as a church, we get to participate in that. And we get to make a commitment. Now, once again, friend, you are free. Whether you give, whether you don't give, that's between you and God. But we ask you to partner with us in what God is doing through Solid Ground. So you can, please don't put your name if you don't, if you're not comfortable with it, it's optional. I don't put my name on the commitment card. It's just between me and God. But there's a once-off giving that you can commit to by a date or a monthly giving for 3, 6, or 12 months. What we do is we sit with a faith offering every year, and we project sort of, we plan and we budget for our missions. And I must honor Solid Ground that every year so far, I haven't really gone and checked the figures for the last faith offering run. I've been a bit distracted with this building project outside here. But every year, we've actually, the actual income into faith offering has exceeded what has been committed. So well done, Solid Ground, for your faithfulness. Well done. But we use this as a tool to budget for our mission endeavors, for whatever we want to do as a church. A large component of our mission at home has been allocated to the building project. So you'll see that we didn't put the building project as a separate thing on the commitment card. But if you've got something specific you want to give towards the building project, there's envelopes, and also into our faith offering account, you can just label that as building project if you want to give specifically to the project. But other than that, between the eldership and a team and myself, we decide and we prayerfully consider where these finances are used and how we apply it. And so that's how we do it. How this is going to work is you can take this offering card home, go and prayerfully consider, and you can bring it next week and put it into the offering basket. Or you can, if you are comfortable with filling it now, our host will be up and down the aisles with some pens and pencils. We're going to give a minute for you to fill in the card. Please, once again, under no obligation to fill it in now. Take it home also if you want to consider it, prayerfully consider what God wants you to give and how to partner with us. And then bring it next week and put it into the offering basket. If you have got something specific to give towards the faith offering this morning, I want to ask you, the host also, there's some envelopes. So everything that is given that is not labeled faith offering is seen as the general tithe and offering. We're just going to have one offering this morning. So please, if you've got something specific to give towards faith offering this morning, put it into a faith offering envelope. Make sure you get one from our hosts. Host, you guys can actually start handing out. If you need a pen or a pencil, you can just raise your hand. Elders, you guys can be released. We're going to ask the band just to minister over us. We're going to give 2 to 3 minutes, and then I'm going to come close the service. But prayerfully consider, and then we'll pass the offering baskets around.